So just two topics before the next test, which is next Friday. Vertical motion, particle motion. A lot of the rules apply to both. Vertical motion is just a more specific application of particle motion. So we'll do the more specific one first, and then we'll sort of expand our horizons on Monday, Tuesday for particle motion. Quiz slash review. I mean, we could have done the test this day, but that would have been kind of a quick turnaround. If you're out Friday, maybe you'd want to take it on block day. You can figure that out next week if that applies to you, and we can discuss, because I think you'd be okay. But I did want a review day built in to make sure we were okay. But if you want to take it early, I think you'd be okay. All right, so I passed out the note sheet, which I need to post now. So let me do a picture of what I said a minute ago. Particle motion is the sort of the overall topic. Vertical motion is a subset of that topic, if that makes sense. So we'll talk about vertical motion today, very specific type of motion, and then we'll expand it next week. Let's cover, there's a lot of physics. Like, a few people noticed that when they walked in, like, wait a minute, this is physics-y stuff. Yes it is. So let's cover a few variables first. I think we know these, but just to make sure we're all on the same page. T stands for time. A is acceleration. V is velocity. How about S? In physics, we don't usually use S. So you may not know what S is, although it's sort of written right there. Position function, S of T equals something. So S is position. In physics, you usually use D, maybe X, maybe Y. I don't know why calculus uses S instead. Some subscripts that I think you know. V0, so the subscript of 0, what's that mean? The initial velocity. And then S0 would be the initial position. So pretty basic stuff there. S might be probably the only new one. Vertical motion. Vertical meaning up and down. So in physics, when you throw a ball up in the air and it comes back down, or you drop something off a cliff, that's vertical motion. So you've done some of these before. Now we're going to look at the sort of the calculus that leads to the equations that you used in physics. Position functions might look familiar. 1/2 at squared plus v0t plus s0. And then these might look familiar as well. On Earth, gravity is, whoops, I said A for acceleration, but on Earth, acceleration is gravity. Negative 32 feet per second squared, or negative 9.8 meters per second squared. So I hope both of those look familiar to you. You've seen those before, used those before. Boxing that, because you got to know that. I don't know what. Here's the connection between, well, actually, hold on. So S of T, if we're in feet, so we would plug in negative 32 times 1/2, we get negative 16 T squared plus V0 T plus S0. So that's just plugging in gravity. In meters, plug in negative 9.8, take half of it, get negative 4.9 T squared plus V0 T plus S0. All right, oh, here's what I meant to do. So you either have to memorize the orange box, or you memorize the green box. Right? I mean, they're kind of the same thing. It's just of how you think of it. One equation with two different gravities, or two different equations with different gravity. So either one, however you want to best think of it to know. Velocity. Let's see. Velocity is distance over time. Like that's the kind of the physics of it. Actually, it's change in distance over change in time would be a better way to say that. And so that's sort of an average velocity, an algebra velocity. But a calculus velocity is ds dt. So that's a small change in distance over a small change in time, ds dt. So that's the derivative of the position function. So negative 32t plus v0. Or if we do it in meters, negative 9.8t plus v0. Acceleration is change in velocity over change in time. But that's sort of the physics average acceleration. The instantaneous acceleration, the calculus acceleration, is dv dt. And so if we take the derivative of negative 32, of negative 32t, we get negative 32. In meters, we get negative 9.8, which is sort of back what we started with. Acceleration's negative 32, or acceleration's negative 9.8. So two more things you have to memorize or know. Velocity is ds dt. Acceleration is dv dt. You get those things, you're good. Like that's the whole of the new stuff, really, for the entire unit. So when we get to particle motion on Monday, we'll change what s is, but v will still be ds dt, a will still be dv dt. So this stuff won't change. We'll just have a harder starting equation. Yes, sir.
Is the acceleration of gravity always negative?
Yes, for vertical motion, because gravity is always pulling down. When we get to particle motion, we throw the stuff out the window and we do something different a little bit. But for vertical motion, acceleration will always be negative. I say that. You can work the problem sort of backwards, and you may have done this in physics, where if you take going down as positive, then you can work with a positive acceleration. It's a little bit backwards, but you can do it. You just have to be careful how you interpret, like everything's backwards. But if everything's going down, maybe it's easier to work it that way. So the answer to your question officially is acceleration due to gravity is always negative, but asterisk on that, because you can tweak that a little bit. Number one, a ball is dropped from a 64-foot tall building. So I bet you guys have done these problems in physics. So let's read this carefully, because there's some like hidden information here. Let's start with the number, because that's the easy one. 64 feet tall. What's that telling me in terms of all these variables that we listed earlier? That's the initial position. There's some other hidden information in that statement, though. Do you remember what it is? Dropped. What does dropped mean? It means the initial velocity is zero. Right? We're not throwing it up. That would be a positive velocity. Throwing it down would be a negative velocity. You're just dropping it. So its initial velocity is zero. It immediately acquires some velocity, but initially its velocity is zero. What are the position, velocity, and acceleration functions? Well, the position function, S of t is, let's see, we're in feet, so negative 16t squared plus 0t, because velocity initial is zero. You don't have to write the 0t, that's sort of me emphasizing it, plus 64. So a little simplified version, negative 16t squared plus 64. That's the only equation I really memorize. After that, I know that velocity is ds dt. So if I take a derivative s, I get negative 32t. The acceleration is the derivative of the velocity, negative 32. I put that as the first example because that's really how we would like you to work these problems, is to write out those things first, and then you've got the three equations you need as you work the problem. Part B, when will the ball hit the ground? So again, some interpretation here. When, so what's it asking in terms of the variables? Time, so when is a time thing, trying to find time, or find t. The ground, what's that code for? Position, and what is the position at the ground? Zero. So we ask these sort of coded questions, but it's the same code from physics. So when means time, ground is zero. So let's use this S equation. So time we don't know, but we do know that S is zero. Use the S equation. Move things around. And we get t equals plus or minus 2, but we don't really go negative time here. So t equals 2 seconds. Because we can't use negative 2, that doesn't really make sense. Find the velocity of the ball on impact. Impact. So that would be when it hits the ground, which means S equals zero. But we know that happens at T equals two. So velocity would be V at time two. So go back and grab the velocity equation. Negative 32 times 2, negative 64. And we're in, everything's in feet and seconds for this problem, so feet per second. Questions on that one? Number two, a rocket is shot upward at 20 meters per second from the ground. Well, again, we got some coded words in here. From the ground, so we're starting at zero. Upward at 20 meters per second. So what's that telling us? V0. Is a positive 20. I mean, it'd be difficult to do a negative 20 if you're starting at the ground, like shooting something into the ground there. What are the position, velocity, and acceleration functions? So, position, S of t equals, we're in meters, so be careful, make sure we grab the meter equation. Negative 4.9 t squared plus 20t plus 0. Again, 0 not really necessary, but trying to emphasize 1 half at squared plus v0t plus s0. Why don't you find the velocity and acceleration functions? All right, part B, what is the velocity after 2 seconds and after 3 seconds? So after 2 seconds would mean plug in 2. And I believe this is a calculator test. Calculators and you. Oops. Plug in 20. Don't forget units, meters per second. Plug in 3. So what's that? Tell me a couple things that this means. Velocity at 2 was 0.4. Velocity of 3 is negative 9.4. So what about the sine thing going on here? What's happened in between there?
It reaches max and now it's coming down.
Yeah, it reaches max and now it's coming down. It was positive velocity. Now it's negative velocity. So somewhere in there it was zero velocity. Technically speaking, that's the intermediate value theorem. Zero is in between positive and negative, so that means it reached its zero velocity in between 2 and 3. It's like a technical term for something that is probably pretty obvious. It reached its max somewhere in there. Somewhere in there it was at zero. When will the rocket change directions? Well, somewhere between 2 and 3 would be one answer. Not a very exact answer, but kind of know where we're looking. What's going on when it changes directions? Like, how do we translate that into a variable? Okay, it is, the S has a max, that's true. But that would mean, if we're thinking maxes, that would mean, like, take a derivative, which is fine. What else? What equals zero?
Velocity
equals zero. In fact, that ties directly with finding the max of S, right? Because we just did the optimize unit. If you want to optimize S, if you want to maximize when it changes directions, you would want ds dt to equal zero. But we know ds dt is v, so there's sort of the connection there. So when, find time, when v is zero. So let's grab the velocity equation. 0 equals negative 9.8 t plus 20. Move things around a little bit. T equals 2.041 seconds. We haven't used the calculator much in here yet, so I haven't really emphasized this yet. But AP, when you use calculator, they want 3 decimal points. So always, 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 unless otherwise stated, but always go to 3 decimal points, because that's what AP will want. How high was it? So how are we going to figure out how high this thing went? Yeah, plug the time, because that's when it was the highest. And plug that into the position equation. And if you want to communicate to the AP reader that you're not just rounding 2.041, that you're carrying all of it in your calculations, you can put a dot, dot, dot. And that sort of tells the reader that, hey, I know there's more there. I'm not writing it all out because I don't want to. But my answer is going to be accurate because I'm going to carry it all in there. And then, you know what? I can even, like, this is, that's enough work to show. So you can go to your calculator. If you tell me what you're going to do, and I know you're going to use your calculator to do it, so I'm looking at the position equation, negative 4.9 times t squared. Are you guys familiar with the answer button on your calculator? Right? It allows you to be super accurate without typing in 2.04081637. You don't want to be doing that. So just use the answer button. Plus 20 times t plus 0. So my height... 20.408, and then I'm thinking units, so I go back and look and see this was a meters problem, so meters, 20 meters. All right, flip it over, top of the next page. That's some average velocity is sort of an algebra velocity, is another way to say it. The average rate of change. We've talked about this before. Change in distance over change in time, or change in y over change in x, compared to a calculus velocity, instantaneous velocity, instantaneous rate of change equals derivatives. Ds dt. So the difference between those, and reading carefully, because we can ask different things. That's exactly what this first question does. Find the average velocity on the interval 1 to 3. Okay, well, the average velocity is the change in position over change in time. The instantaneous velocity is ds dt. So the subtle but important difference between delta s, that would be change, and ds, that would be derivative. So change in position, so this is the algebra stuff, s of 3 minus s of 1 over 3 minus 1. Like algebra 1, slope formula, average rate of change. So probably out to the side somewhere, we need to figure out what S of 3 is, perhaps with a calculator. Negative 16 times 9 plus 12 plus 200. I squared 3 and got 9, though. I don't know. Why am I doing math in my head when I'm actually using my calculator, I guess? It's maybe the better question. Plug in 1, I get negative 16 plus 4 plus 200. 188. So 68 minus 188 over 3 minus 1. And actually, that's a safe stop, right? That's done. You can be done there if you wanted to. Meters per second. I mean, I don't really know why you'd stop there when it's a calculator problem, but just if you didn't want to go on, it's okay to leave it there. ds dt, negative 32t plus 4, but then evaluate that at 3 seconds. Remember, that's the... We can show that with a bar, and t equals 3 means evaluate at t equals 3. Negative 32 times 3 plus 4. And now you can leave that if you wanted to. Negative 92 feet per second. So average velocity versus instantaneous velocity. Example 4, same type stuff, except instead of velocity, it's just y's and x's. So this is really old news here, but we haven't done it in a while. And so it's worthwhile revisiting here. Average rate of change. That's good old algebra slope. Y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. This is algebra 1, except we don't use the term average rate of change in algebra 1. 7 cubed. That's why we have the calculator. 7 cubed minus 3, 340. 2 cubed minus 3 I can do. 8 minus 3 is 5. So 340 minus 5 over 7 minus 2. Again, feeling lazy, you could leave it. If you want to see what it is, then you can type it in the calculator. Get 67. Instantaneous rate of change, that's calculus slope. That's dy dx. That's the derivative. So 3x squared at x equals 3. That's not a safe stop because you haven't plugged it in yet. So you're close, but you're not quite done yet. 3 times 3 squared. That would be a safe stop. You could stop at 3 times 3 squared. 3 times 9 is 27. So example 4 was entirely old news, but we're trying to relate the idea of algebra slope and calculus slope to average velocity, instantaneous velocity. Example 5. A rock is dropped from a height of 400 feet, initial position. In t seconds, the rock drops a distance of s equals 16 t squared. Find the position function. I don't like this second statement, because it's not necessary. The position function is negative 16 t squared. Let's see, dropped means the initial velocity is 0, plus 400. This sort of gets to Andrew's question earlier. If you want to use this formula, that formula is measuring how far it has fallen. But that seems kind of backwards. The formula we would like to use is measuring from the ground up with our normal formula. So you can use either one, but it just always seems confusing to me if you're measuring from, I mean, I guess it sometimes makes sense, measure from where you started rather than measuring from the ground. If you're careful, you could use either one. I'm going to use that bottom one because that makes more sense to me. How long does it take to reach the ground? So a little bit of interpretation, but again, it's the same type of interpretation you had to do in physics. So find the time. Ground is s equals 0. You've got a calculator. We know you have a calculator. So if you do a lot of this work in the calculator, that's fine. 400 divided by 16 is 25. Kind of nice when they work out nice for us. What is the average velocity during this time? Okay, average velocity is change in position over change in time. As opposed to looking ahead, instantaneous velocity is ds dt. So comparing those two. So during this time, so that means s5 minus s0 over 5 minus 0. What's S5? I don't really need to plug this in because I know what's happening at 5 seconds. Why did we pick 5? It was on the ground. So I know S of 5 is 0. S of 0 is where we started. So 400. 400 divided by 5 is 80. Negative 80. Negative because it's traveling down. We can skip D because it's kind of the same thing, except it's S3 minus S0. So you'd have to go find S of 3. But then the process would be the same. I want to skip down to E because I really want to make sure we understand the difference between average and instantaneous. It's that algebra versus calculus idea. So the derivative is negative 32t. When it hits the ground, well, we already figured out that that was t equals 5. Negative 32 times 5. Negative 160 feet per second. I think that makes sense. That its average velocity over the first 5 seconds is negative 80. Right? Because it starts at v equals 0. Its instantaneous velocity when it hits the ground is negative 160. So the average, and this doesn't always work like this. It works for vertical motion. But the average should be somewhere in between there. Not necessarily like the math algebra average where you just add the two numbers and divide by 2. That's dangerous. It works for this one, but not always the case. But it makes sense that the average would at least be between 0 and negative 160. Example 6 is just more of the same stuff, so we can pass on example 6. I'll pass out the worksheet, and the answers are... Oops, not on the back. So I'll post the answers so you can have those to look at.